Greetings and Happy New Year to all our viewers. This is your Polish-American Connection TV program, and I'm the producer and host, Tom Gajewski. We'd like to welcome all of you to the show. And certainly wish everyone who's watching tonight and the Polish-American Heritage Association, as well as the Polish community in general, a very happy, healthy, and prosperous New Year. I'd like to thank the Bernardine Franciscan Sisters for their performance of Christmas carols and Kalendy back in December. They did an excellent program. I'd also like to thank and congratulate Henry Prusky for his work in putting together a wonderful Vigilia for the Polish-American Heritage Association. Our January program now opens the year with a special focus on a program that's operated in the city that doesn't get very much advertisement, but it's an important component in terms of the service it provides for our community. But before we start, just like to give you a couple reminders. One is to please get a pencil and paper, because we do have a number of events that we'll cover at the end, and you may want to make some notes. And the other is that this is a two-way program, and you're welcome to call in and ask any question or comment, or make any comment that you care to. The only thing we ask is that you state your question or make your comment, and then give us an opportunity to respond to it. That way, if there are several, we can try to get everybody in. this program is special in a couple ways, as I say, particularly in terms of the service that it provides, and it's sponsored by the Bernardine Franciscan Sisters, and we're very proud tonight to have with us Sister Antoinette and Sister Paula, and they'll be telling us about the mission and the activities of the Bernardine Franciscan Sisters. So with that, welcome, sisters, and we'll turn to you, Sister Antoinette, to start us off. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself, maybe?
Hello, I'm Sister Antoinette Kaiser. My hometown is Coltmount, Pennsylvania, and presently I'm on the leadership team for the Bernardine Franciscan Sisters.
And I am Sister Paula Novak, and I'm originally from St. Mary's of Ostrobrama Parish in South River, New Jersey, and I am a math instructor at Alvernia University.
Okay, Sister Paula, could you tell us a little bit about the history?
Well, as families have ancestors, so does communities. So we are Franciscan because we follow the third order of St. Francis of Assisi. St. Bernardine of Siena was also a Franciscan, and he was a great preacher. And at times, he was even called the second St. Paul. St. Bernardine liked to promote devotion to the holy name of Jesus, so he used a monogram of IHS, which is the first three letters of Jesus in Greek, in order to promote this devotion. And he also blessed the people after every sermon. St. Bernardine had a friend, St. John Capistrano. So around 1457, he was asked by the king and bishop of Poland to come and preach to the people. So he did, and then afterwards, the bishop gave him a church in Krakow, Poland. And naturally, St. John named it St. Bernardine after his friend who was just canonized a saint. Then there was a group of widows who came to St. John and said, we would like to have the third order rule so that we could live as a community and still take care of the needy. So St. John gave them the third order rule, and these women lived next to the church of St. Bernardine. So shortly, the townspeople started calling them Bernardine Sisters. Many years later, in 1882, a Bernardine Franciscan convent was founded in Zakliczyn, and this would be the convent that the sisters would come to America. Now, also at this time in this period, many sisters from other communities sent people to the United States to work with the immigrants, and their ministries were in education and also in healthcare. Our American foundress, Mother Veronica Zhendowska, was born Emily Eleanor, and she went to school with, and the sisters there were called the Congregation of Mary. After she graduated, she entered that community and was given the name of Sister Veronica. After only about 2 years, the war with Russia forced the convent to be disbanded, so she had to leave. In around 23 years, she became a bookkeeper for her brother, and she always prayed Psalm 91 in order to have her trust in divine providence. Well, when she was 42, she decided she wanted to enter the community again. So she looked into the Felician Sisters, who are another community from Poland. And because she was so old, they told her that they would send her to the United States. So she really loved Poland, so she says, no, thank you, and she left. Then she went and found the Bernardine Sisters in Zakliczyn, and they said, oh, no problem. So she entered, and to her surprise, she also got the name of Sister Veronica. Mm. Now, 10 years later, a letter came to Mother Hedwig, who was the superior of the convent, and it was from the pastor of Mount Carmel, St. Joseph's Parish in Mount Carmel. And he was asking for sisters to come in order to teach the children of the Polish immigrants who were working in his parish. So Sister prayerfully discerned, and she was going to send four sisters to the United States. And she named Mother Veronica as the superior of that group. Now, Mother Veronica did not want to come to the United States, but she trusted in divine providence that the Lord would protect them and they would be all right. Well, they landed in the United States on October 16, 1894 in Ellis Island. And before being sent to Mount Carmel, Mother Veronica bought a statue of the Sacred Heart of Jesus and also a crucifix. Now, their first year in Mount Carmel had many difficulties. So the sisters decided that they were going to return to Poland. So they went to Bishop McGovern in Harrisburg to ask permission if they could go back. Well, he gave them permission, and they got on a train from Harrisburg, and they had to switch trains in Reading to get to Mount Carmel. But they missed the connection. Hmm. So the people called the pastor of St. Mary's, Father Maliszewski, and he came to help the stranded sisters. He heard their story, and he said, well, don't go back to Poland. Stay here in Reading and teach at St. Mary's. So they did. And then one day, a knock came at the door, and a little orphan girl named Mary was dropped off. So now Mother Veronica had to assume the responsibility of taking care of orphans. When the convent was getting small, and they lived on 12th and Spruce, she had the help of Monsignor Bornemann to help find another convent. So they found Ridgewood. Now, Ridgewood today would be, the convent would be on top of the hill above the animal shelter that's on Route 724, right before you get to 176. So from there, they actually walked to Reading back and forth. Then that became too small, so Monsignor Bornemann also helped them to build the Sacred Heart Convent, which is now on Mount Alvernia, in 1906. So in 2014, we celebrated 120 years of service in the United States. And the picture that you're seeing is of the community when it was only 10 years old, and Mother Veronica is in the middle.
Sister, I know you're a math teacher, but you could do very well as a history teacher as well. So thank you. That was a very nice rendition. Sister Antoinette, can you tell us about the ministries in which the congregation is involved?
Sure. I'd like to start here talking about our main ministries right here in Reading, Pennsylvania, where Mother Veronica started working with the Polish immigrants. And she established our mother house in the United States. After the convent, which we call our mother house, was built, a second building was built by our pioneering sisters, and it was a building for ministries. This second building was the orphanage. It was located right next to the main building, and that building, which started as the orphanage, housed hundreds of orphans. And incidentally, just this Sunday, I read in the Reading Eagle that Wally Scott, who was running for mayor, attended that orphanage. There was also a school there for local children, an elementary school. And the building went from being an orphanage with an elementary school to an aspirancy for young women who were thinking about joining the sisters to a high school. And then around 1958, that high school building merged into the first and only building that was Alvernia College. 3 years ago, the building known as Francis Hall was renovated and enlarged. And it houses the president's offices, the theater, the performing arts department, Reading Police Academy, and even some housing for students. The first graduating class of the university consisted of four sisters, but now they have an average of 3,000 students on three different campuses. And that one building has evolved into 30. In 2008, on the 50th anniversary of Alvernia College, it became Alvernia University. Alvernia is a top-notch Franciscan university that lives its motto, to live, to love, and to serve. And back in the early years, after the sisters were settled in St. Mary's, they migrated to upstate Pennsylvania, Shenandoah, Hazleton, Wilkes-Barre, Scranton area. And they established hospitals, orphanages, and schools all over the state. In fact, as far west as Butler, PA. And another little incident, this morning we buried a sister who was 102 years old, and her first mission was in Butler, Pennsylvania, when she was 15 years old. So we've been there, been around for a while. Also in Reading, we have our newest ministries that are designated to help immigrants. We have a group of ministries housed in St. Joseph's Parish in Reading. This project includes a program for 4-year-olds whose first language is not English, so that they would be prepared to enter an English-speaking school system. The second part of the project is a tutoring class for school-aged children. The children are from the neighborhood. The teachers are from teachers and students from Alvernia and some of the sisters. The project also includes classes for adults who are preparing for their American citizenship test. These are held in the evening, and the teachers are sisters. Going back in time, also in Pennsylvania though, in the mid-1940s, the Bernardine Franciscan Sisters acquired a hotel in the Poconos that was closing. In a very short time, it was converted into Our Lady of the Pocono Retreat House. The hotel made a perfect retreat house because it had many rooms, and each room had private baths. And they can accommodate groups now as large as 90, or several small groups, or even individual retreatants. It's the perfect place to get in touch with God with the help of the beautiful grounds, and it's located in Mount Pocono, Pennsylvania. In 1986, the Bernardine Franciscan Sisters founded the Bernardine Center to help provide a helping hand to the residents of Chester when that city moved from a flourishing oil refining city to an impoverished city without any profitable industry. The Bernardine Center is a quite extensive program. They have a food distribution center where they give out hundreds of bags of food to poor families every week. They have a clothing distribution center where they give out clothing either free or at a minimal charge. And they have a place where people can get a hot meal 3 or 4 days a week. One of our sisters does the planning and the cooking with the help of volunteers. They also provide classes in anger management, parenting, computer, food preparation, and GED preparation. That's helping adults get their high school degree. They do advocacy for the poor, as well as for justice, peace, and earth care issues. And all of this is done with one full-time sister who is the director and the sister who takes care of the hot brunch for the people, along with volunteers, many of whom are Bernardine Franciscan associates. And that's most of our places in Pennsylvania.
Okay, thank you, Sister. Equally well done. If we can come back to you, Sister Paul, I'd like to ask, where else do you have ministries, and can you tell us briefly about them?
We have a hospital in Newport News, Virginia, Mary Immaculate Hospital, and it started like 1952, and it's now part of the Bon Secours system, and it is a short-term hospital with specialties in orthopedics. We also have Villa Maria Education Center in Stamford, Connecticut, which was developed in order to help students with learning disabilities from grades K through 9. And because their learning differences are recognized, understood, and addressed, they prosper. We also have sisters in Michigan who work with the mentally challenged in group homes called Angel's Place. And as Mother Veronica came to the United States, the congregation also sent sisters to Brazil in 1937. And the two places that we first went to were Kamakwa and a Polish settlement called Dom Feliciano. So the sisters are there, we have a provincial house, and now in order to continue the missionary spirit, the sisters are in the northeast of Brazil along the Amazon with Dominican Republic and also Mozambique.
Wow, pretty widespread.
Yes.
Sister Antoinette, can you tell us where the viewers can learn more about the religious Polish American influence in our area and something about the Heritage Room at Alvernia?
Yes, we have a Congregational Heritage Room, which is located in the Mother House, and it exhibits many artifacts from Mother Veronica's time and history from our time in Poland as well as our early time in the United States. You can also browse through the many books at the Polish American Room in the Franco Library on the grounds of Alvernia College, which was made possible through the contribution of Daniel and Helen Kubacki. And of course, there's your Polish American Cultural Room at the Goggle Works in downtown Reading. Mm-hmm. As you've seen, the Bernardine Franciscan Sisters continue the legacy of Mother Veronica, who came to the United States from Poland to do what God wanted her to do. We are responding to the very real needs of people, both near and far, and doing it with a membership that is older and smaller than many people would imagine. And we'd like to leave you with the words of St. Francis, who spoke to his brothers from his deathbed. I have done what is mine to do. May God teach you to do what is yours to do. We, the Bernardine Franciscan Sisters, have done and are doing what is ours to do as our legacy of Mother Veronica. May you continue to listen and pray so that you too may learn to carry on and carry out what is yours to do. Thank you, good night, and may the Lord give you peace.
Thank you, very well done. And I think you have some information on how viewers can contact your congregation as well. And if they're interested in coming over and taking a look at the Heritage Room,
that's
possible.
As you can see, we're located at 460 St. Bernardine Street in Reading. And we have a website, which is www.franciscan.org. And the phone number that you see on the screen is for our communications office. And so if you have some questions, you can call there and get some answers for your questions.
And I've seen it myself, and I can tell you it's very impressive. And if any of you has the opportunity to get over there, I would encourage you to do that. Thank you very much, sisters. It was a pleasure having you. And what we'll do at this point then is go into some of the activities we have coming up. So if we could begin with those, please. The Goggle Works is located on the fifth floor at 2nd and Washington Streets, and that's where we have our Polish American Cultural Center. It's open Saturdays and Sundays from noon to 4 p.m., and this will give you an opportunity to learn about and enjoy your heritage. And of course, admission is free, and parking in the rear of the building is also free, And I might add that you still can catch the Christmas display that's currently there if you get down there this week. I don't know how much longer it will be up, but it will be up this Sunday. Polish American Heritage Center, we're asking for volunteers to help with that. If you have 2 hours that you can contribute each month, that would be very much appreciated. That's all it's asked, and there isn't a lot of training involved, and there is an opportunity to ask questions so you're prepared. If you're interested, contact Marilyn at 610-779-5523. Novelty buttons and other items that are ways of displaying your Polish heritage are available at Christina's Kitchen at the Fairgrounds Market. There's the phone number to contact, and it's always good to be proud to be a Polish American. You can also get those novelty buttons and t-shirts through looseends.biz. You have to go on the computer to do that, but it's a good way to take a look at the entire inventory of things that they have available. And again, this is a way to show your pride and your Polish American heritage. Volunteers are needed at the Polish American Heritage Center, just 2 hours a month, and you contact Marilyn at 610-779-5523. And there are a number of Polish radio programs in our community. Walter K. has his program on WREW 1340 AM or 1340WREW.com Sundays from 10 to 1 p.m. And then Kaz has his German Bavarian Polka Party show on WEEU 8:30 a.m. And if we could change to the next, there we go, 8:30 a.m. from 10 a.m. to noon. And then there's a Polish American radio program that's on 24 hours a day with various Polish programming. And again, it's 7 days a week, it's on 24 hours a day. And there's the information to tune it in if you'd like to give it a listen. Okay, with that, we'd like to say thank you for watching. Thank you. We just finished our 15th year, and we're pleased to be able to have this program with you. And we'd like to thank all of our viewers for your continued support and our sponsors as well for their support. And I'd like to ask you to take good care of yourself. And until the first Tuesday in February, which I believe is the 4th, at 7:30 on Channel 15 Comcast, Channel 19 Select TV. Take care, God bless, and always be proud to be Polish. Thank you.